They knew we were coming. Like took us an hour to get out there, that we would get IED'd constantly. And we'd crest this one like terrain feature and just get stitched up every single time. But we would, this one in particular, a new guy on the team, Ryan Hendrickson, which is an SF teammate of mine. That was his first deployment with the team. And he was driving, and I was like the vehicle. I was in the passenger seat, and one of the first rounds it hits the windshield in front of him, is a driver, his face, and just spalls it, right? Like definitely a disc around, but like he pulled up in there into the four walls. He jumps out. He goes and like walks over to one of the Afghans, and he's like, "Let me get a cigarette." And like just starts like smoking this cigarette, like. And I was just like, "You all right?" It was just, it was really welcome to Afghanistan.
We were going to be clearing the village of Seapest. And it was multiple compounds, but we had taken a lot of fire from there. So we knew bad guys were in the area. And if they weren't in the area, then there's going to be IEDs in the area for sure. We had dealt with IEDs up to that point, but we knew that once we got past that certain part in the river, everything was going to be IED'd. And so we get up to our first basically controlled stop. And now it's 1 a.m. You know, we had moved for a couple hours, slow movements. I'm up in the front with my Afghans, and we're clearing the route like everyone always does, and just slow movement to the first set of compounds. And as we had rehearsed with our Afghan partners, they were actually a militia force. And as we rehearsed with them, it's like, we're gonna get to a certain point, then you guys are gonna go and clear this compound.
We had to clear out the Taliban from that village in order to then get over, because we couldn't, the choke point, like to try to get around the mountain pass here, like it was a footpath. Like the most, like they'd get the little bikes through there, like loaded down with 16 people and shit, but like still, like we couldn't use that as our way to get in and occupy. So we planned this big mission we did a damn Zodiac crossing at night. And we put like an ATV on one Zod with a bunch of people, and then the other Zodiac, we just did a rope bridge and just like pull ourselves across. But like we needed supplies, and because we knew once we went over there, like we were gonna like have to own it. And that was the mission that we had gotten reports from human intelligence or whatever, like that night before, that they were booby trapping the doorways.
We're gonna have our first command and control. We're gonna have our first C2C. So, okay, good to go. Just like we rehearsed. So we got to the first point, about 25 meters away from the first compound. And I told our interpreter, Nick, I was like, all right, Nick. Yeah, tell him, let's go. All right, go clear that compound. It's like, yeah, doing Green Beret shit here. It's good stuff. No one's moving.
So we're like, okay. I'm like, is anything changing the calculus here of like why we're doing this without like, you know, planning a little bit further into this versus like, well, we'll just go up and over the walls or blow holes in the walls? I'm like, yeah, that's cool. That takes forever. And like, part of me just was like, I wish I would have said something more like in that moment. But the mission, like through resources, everything kind of came together, and we had to do it that night. And we did, and coming across, like we had to clear every like step we took. And thank God we had like a local Afghan force that was like switched the f*** on with finding these things, man. Like, but there was only a few of them. So each, like I had few of those trained Afghans that were expertly trained in detection. And
what are they detecting?
Explosives, IEDs.
Okay.
Yeah, either road or like foot or mobile. They saved my life I don't know how many times.
Let's go clear this compound. They said it's too dangerous. Well, no shit. That's why we're here. I know this. It's very dangerous. Tell him again. Okay, he tells him no.
You know, going over, we had to be very methodical with our movement and using the cover of darkness to move slowly through and clearing to get to breach. And we had five elements, right? So it was me and another ODA guy, and then a squad of local forces that we trained. And then one of those, like the only other Afghan I trusted, like there was one of those cats. So it was like, he was up front with me, and I got to breach. I was like the lead element, and then there was another two elements that went into the irrigation to clear that out. So my element was the furthest north, and then Ryan Hendrickson's element was with the team sergeant, and then their squad
said no. But that's not what we planned. We practiced this. You can't say no, can you? You can't say no. Oh, okay. Well, why? Said it's too dangerous. This is, you know, you're better trained, you should go first. It's like, well, yeah, if this was Texas, and we were clearing a small town in Texas from insurgents, I would, yeah, it's my country, I'll go first, yeah. But this is your country. Let's go. No. It's like, all right. So I turned around to tell my teammate, who was actually the team sergeant also, turned around to tell him, like, hey, these guys aren't moving. And he grabs me and he's like, go get Nick away from that door right now.
And he goes to, I guess the interpreter, like, stepped in front of the doorway at the building he was at.
It's like, what are you talking about? So our interpreter had wandered down to the first breach point, doorway, whatever you want to call it, of compound 001. And he's trying to wave him down, you know, still noise and light discipline. So he's not yelling, you know, follow me or anything like that. He's just trying to wave him down. Well, he's our only terp. And and we have a bunch of militia guys with us. So it's like, go get him away from that door now. It's like, oh shit. So I'll backtrack here in a second, but I wander down to where he's at and I grab him on the shoulder.
And he goes to tell him, like, no, don't get out of the doorway.
So, you know, what are you doing, man? What the f*** are you doing? Back up now. Move back to Lance's position. What are you doing? Stupid, you know? And so he steps away from the breach and I cover his movement back, because as of right now, whatever is inside of that compound is the unknown. We don't know if a guy is about ready to stick an AK barrel out there and start spraying. Have no idea. So I'm covering his movement back, and then I see something kind of move out of the corner of the compound. I'm like, oh, what is that? I need to get a better look at this. And then I can't really quite see it. I don't know what it was. Was it a cat? Was it a person? Is someone moving up along the wall? I have no idea. So I take a step in to look, and boom.
And when he did that, like, he basically put his weight onto the pressure plate ID and just set it off.
I'd stepped on a pressure plate IED in the breach point.
I heard, like, the explosion, and then I heard and felt like a thud, a body just thud, you know, hitting the ground. And then pause, and then these wails of just pain and agony. And I knew the voice, I could hear it, the earshot, you know, and crickets on the radio. And I was just like, oh. And I went to go run over there, because it wasn't that far from me, maybe 50 yards, like, not direct, but a very indirect route, but straight line, 50 yards. And I went to go run, and Ahmed Shah grabs me again. I'm like, nobody puts their hands on me. And he says, Kyle, his English wasn't great, but, like, when he spoke to me, I knew, like, how it was serious. Like, when he spoke to me in a way that he did. And he's like, no, let me go. But it felt like it took so long to get back to Ryan.
I'm laying there, and as the ringing and everything, I'm like, okay, I can't move. I don't know why I can't move, but you know, I just stop, control your breathing. What happened? RPG, recoilless, like what happened? I know what I'm supposed to be doing right now, because I've seen guys get blown up and you start screaming and stuff like that. It's like, what happened? And then as the dust starts to clear, and again, I'm talking minutes here, this is seconds, you know, but as the dust starts to clear, I look down at my right leg, and it's my boot is at a 90 degree angle to my leg. And so I'm trying to figure out, because again, let's go back to the ASVAB test score, not the brightest. I'm trying to figure out why my boot is pointing at a 90 degree angle to my leg. It's like, well, I didn't take my boot off, but so the dust clears a little bit more, and now I'm hearing, you know, people are, Lance is yelling like, Ryan, Ryan, you okay, Ryan? And I pick my leg up from behind the knee, and my boot flops over. And then I see, sticking out of my pant legs, I see these two pearly white objects. Like, the bone should be the color of bone. You can't call it white. It's this whole new glowing, you know, it's September 12th, it's 4 something in the morning, it's about that time when you're like, do I need nods? Yes, no, you know, that kind of time. But these two objects that are sticking out of my pant leg are like glowing white. And then I realized that's my tib and my fib. And then it hit me. The pain, just, oh, shit, there it is. I'm hit. And yeah, that's like that pain of, God, I've never felt anything like that before. Just excruciating pain. And it felt like it took forever for it to hit me, because I had to realize what happened.
Did he put the tourniquet on you?
No. No. I remember looking back, because I'm laying this way, here's the compound, and I can see Lance in the background. And he seemed so far away. And I remember I laid my head back and I said, I'm gonna die here today. No one can get to me. And I remember looking up, and I instantly started going through my life and the mistakes that I've made and the people that I hurt and the paths of destruction that I had created. And I was ashamed of myself, that I was going to die there that day, never of ever being a man. I was always a little boy. And that's how I was gonna die. And so I remember asking God for forgiveness and understanding that, you know, I mean, people could read into it and say, oh, well, you gave up, you accepted death. Okay. Maybe I did. I don't know what mind state I was in, but I remember looking up and I was asking God for forgiveness. And then there was this hawk flying, just circling me. And it was crazy. It was like, we're in a full fight right now. The Taliban they were moving down the river. Our overwatch guys were engaging them. Aircraft were coming in, engaging them. There's a fight going on all around me, and there's just this one hawk circling me with the aircraft and everything. So I laid my head back, and it took about probably, and I was like, I'm just gonna go to sleep. Slap. And teammates got to me. George Magana and Kyle Morgan.
I got there and just the snapshot, I can see it, is the team sergeant's on his knees, like over here, and like Ryan's over here in agony, like bleeding, blood is everywhere and just bleeding out. And I'm like, what in the f*** are you doing? And he's sitting there like on his knees, like trying to pull his tourniquet out, and it's still in the plastic. And I just, I'm like, you're f***ing useless, like in my mind, and just went over. And by that point, my other teammate, George, like had gotten there and actually got the tourniquet on Ryan's leg. And then I was able to help George, like, you know, work through the stuff with Ryan, but his leg was just hanging on by like the flesh.
So now Kyle is like, Ryan, it's gonna hurt really bad. I'm picking you up, I gotta carry you. And it was extremely painful. But Kyle picks me up, fireman carry, and starts moving to where we can set up an HLZ and actually land a Black Hawk to get me out of there.
Kyle carried you 1,000 to 1,500 meters?
Yeah, we had to stop a couple times so he could, you know, kind of loosen up a little bit.
How was he carrying you? Fireman's carry?
Yeah, fireman's carry. But he just kept moving.
With full kit?
Yeah.
With, holy shit.
Yeah.
He had lost so much blood. And I didn't think he was going to make it, like, right there. And, but I knew that, like, I was like, all right, who's got a litter? Who's got the litter? You know, I'm like starting taking control, like as they're working, like Jorge's, you know, making sure the tourniquet stopped the bleeding. And then we're splinting his leg with his own rifle and like to try to like put it back into place. And then I look at the medic and I'm like, where's the litter? He's like, we don't have one. I'm like, you don't have a litter? I'm like, you don't even have a Polis litter? Like, what? Not like, so I was like about to just like detonate right then, but I was like, all right. So I just went into and found a whoopee and just freaking busted out a whoopee and put him on that. And I was like, grab a corner, let's go. You call in the medevac, tell them to come right there. And like, out of like using that we were taking fire from the Taliban over here, using the buildings to mask our movement, it was exposed, but it was maybe 500-600 yards from the injury site. And you know, so they're on the horn with the medevac, but we're starting to move them, and the freaking paunch or the whoopee just freaking rips all apart, and we stop. And I'm like, the team sergeant tells me that, well, they won't land right there. We gotta move them another kilometer that way. I'm like, call that. I'm like, no, you tell them it's safe where we're at. Like, we got you covered. Like, come in and get him out of here. And I got in this like back and forth with him. And I was like, all right, f*** it. You make a decision. Silence. All right, fuck it. This is what we're doing. And I throw Ryan on my shoulders and just run with him for that whole like 1,000 yards, man. And got him, placed him onto the helicopter and said goodbye to him. And I didn't think I was going to see him again.
And I didn't realize that the whole team knew that was my last flight. I was going to die on the helicopter.
We only really have one perspective, and that's yours. So I got one of your teammates on the line here, Kyle Morgan.
Hey everybody, I'm Shawn Ryan. Click here to subscribe to the Shawn Ryan Show YouTube channel for the hottest and most compelling interviews that you will not see anywhere else. I've also made a playlist of all the previous SRS episodes, so they're easy to find. You can find that right here.